You're so refreshed and happy to be in Los Angeles.
Yes, I feel good.
Does it feel like you've been on tour for a month or?
This one's a lot lighter. Obvious Child, yeah. They had Jenny and I going to many, many cities real quickly. I know we were in Phoenix, but I don't really remember.
Phoenix was, where did we take the picture with that umbrellas? I was going to say, are we recording?
Yeah, we are.
Oh, okay. Just like, making sure. I don't see a light.
Phoenix was when they announced on the airplane
that it was too hot to take off.
So they're going to take some of the fuel out of
it. Yeah, they were like, we're taking fuel out. And we were like...
And people. And I was like, wait, the pilot and...
Well, was there something fun about it being like, you know, the Virgin Tour that last time?
It was amazing.
Yeah, we had such a good time.
And this is great too. Like, I'm not jaded at all by this experience. The only thing is that, you know, our premiere was last night and I'm just hungover. But I had a good time.
I had a really good time, and I took my shoes off, which I feel like is a sign of a good party. I also took my shoes off at my bat mitzvah. By the way, I did. And I chugged so much soda and like flipped out.
So is this like a bat mitzvah every day? Is the three of you on tour together? Is this like a...
Is this like a bat mitzvah every day? Yeah, it is.
Have you gotten used to this every day?
You never get used to it.
No. I feel very, like, excited. I just, after we made Obvious Child, I don't think I had any sort of, like, looking into the future and some sort of idea of what our next project would be. I think I had this really beautiful feeling that was like, wow, what we just did was really meaningful to me, and I've opened like a creative passageway within myself, and now I know it's there and I want to see where else it goes. And although that was only a couple years ago, it feels like this movie that we made really represents a new phase of, I think, our kind of collective womanhood and adulthood. And I feel like I'm kind of entering this situation with like a new deportment in a way. I feel like very, I don't know, very proud.
Is it very different than being a voice in a, as it, you know, in Zootopia or?
Sure.
I mean, is the experience of having that happen and having success happen, is that terribly, is that important to you in the same way at all as this is, or?
I don't know, that doesn't super connect to me. Like, the animated films that I do just feel like, they feel like beautiful little fun vacations. Mm-hmm. It's such a different type of performance than what we do, and what we do feels like an ecosystem that we're like constantly doing maintenance on and like touring around, you know, within this thing, and our relationship is very familial and feels like a sisterhood, mm-hmm. and it just runs really deep. But we're also like, you know, we're doing our jobs. So the tie-in is very, I don't know, feels very complex and nice. And this is what I would want from myself, like an integrated personal and creative life. That's what I would hope for.
It's so nice that we get to go off and live our lives separately and be artists, you know, singular artists, mm-hmm. but then come together with what we've learned.
So when you guys were developing the script and getting it together, I mean, was there a thought to the fact that it's a next step, or that you're trying to push the emotional envelope a little further this time, or in a different way?
Of course. I think we knew we wanted to work with each other again and build on our strengths, but also find ways to challenge each other and help each other grow. You know, writing this movie for Jenny, wanting to make sure that Dana Jacobs was different from Donna Stern, and that it was, you know, a fresh idea and a role that maybe Jenny hasn't played before, and to have a character to really dig into that explored different sides of her and that reflected kind of, as you were saying, our new woman, the new womanhood of all of us.
Is there any sense when you put together a project like this, what that it might or might not get made? or is that now kind of an assumption that you guys have got enough of a foot in the business that
no,
you can get this signal
every project can fall apart and oh does 100 times
until you're in the scene
and even when you're in it.
I'm always afraid I'm like, going to be walking from my like trailer to the thing and they're going to be like, we
done.
Yeah,
Jen, you're wrapped. I didn't even get any sides.
One of the many things that binds us is a deep paranoia, for sure.
Yeah.
But I think every project, you know, comes together and falls apart 100 times. With this movie, we had the really good fortune of finding partners who, you know, we pitched this vague idea of like untitled divorce comedy to them, and they signed on board, you know, for us to write a script and for Gillian to direct and me to produce and Jenny to star. So we knew from day one that we had their backing and that they wanted to make this movie. But there's 1,000 steps between that and, you know, being on set. And, you know, it's always, everything's a little touch and go. But I think that's also part of the fun, or at least I, you know, I try and tell myself it's part of the fun.
Yeah.
Is it fun, Gillian?
It's so much fun. It's, you know, the only thing I know how to do and love doing. And
you know
it's
how
a
to
privilege.
Pack a suitcase, girl.
I can pack a suitcase.
My suitcases for me.
It's scary. It makes me think that you're maybe like a double agent or something. It's very like CIA.
I'm very good
at
organizing. Yeah. I love Excel spreadsheets. I love lists. And that really taps into my sort of organized part of my brain. But I also don't like to use that too often. I really do like to be as creative as possible every day and get things like a little messed up when I can, when I allow myself to be messy. But it's just, it's a long process for sure. And I'm used to that. I'm used to things not coming quickly or easily, starting from, you know, my childhood and being dyslexic and reading came slow. But with Obvious Child, the short, we made it in 2009 and didn't make the feature until 2013. So it's a marathon, and I know how to like protect myself. I'm getting better at it. I don't think I know fully how to do it every day, but you know, we're a good team and we bring each other up, but we also help each other when you know, you get that call where it's just like, are we greenlit yet? And you just don't know.
Until has it changed in 4 years? I mean, is the business, I mean, you came out of crowdfunding, was one of your previous lives, right?
Yes, so. I ran film for Kickstarter for 4 years, which was awesome. And yeah, the business changes every 6 months. I mean, I think.
But it just keeps on changing. It's not like it ever gets easier or bigger or.
I don't think so. I think there's always like new tools and new players. And there's new opportunities, but then also new challenges. And you're constantly just figuring out where you fit in there and what is the thing that's right for your film and your team.
Have you made a conscious choice to work in more challenging films and as opposed to doing the, you know, 15th lead in whatever giant movie there is at a studio,
yeah,
or third, eighth
really
lead
do
or whatever?
That.
Yeah, you don't really do that.
I don't like to. And I mean, I would love to be in a big studio movie if it were good, mm-hmm. or there would be something that I can do. But I feel very uncomfortable when I feel that there is a massive amount of potential energy in me, and I'm only allowed to make it go kinetic and make it come out through like a tiny pinhole. Mm-hmm. You know, like it's like there's two doors there. I want them to open. And I would just like to be in an environment that allows me to do that. So, you know, there are a few things at play. Usually in big studio comedies, for example, for the most part, those comedies are about men, and then there are women who are their like sort of counterparts there to support them. And the women, even now, are like, it's just not, those characters are not super interesting. I also have the luxury of like having the financial stability from animated features. Mm-hmm. So I don't feel the stress that maybe I felt like 4 years ago, you know. But at this point, yeah, I don't really do network TV. And I haven't done a big giant like live action studio movie, but I would like to. I just want to work with good directors and have something to do. I really would rather be unemployed than bored or somehow degraded on a set.
And is that more true now than it was before things blew up with Obvious Child? I mean, have you become even more, have a heavier embrace of pushing?
You still love being degraded on set.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I mean, my preferences have always been the same, but I think I just think in general I have more of a peaceful sense of what works for me. I think when my career started, I was like, I mean, even being on SNL, like, you just have to make this work. Mm-hmm. You just have to make it work. And now I'm kind of like, no, you don't. I've compared it a lot in the last few days to, like, to love or romantic relationships, but it's like, sorry, sometimes that just doesn't work. It's
also
not
confidence and inner peace and all those things that come with doing it more.
Yeah, doing it more. Having respect for your skill set, defining who what your identity is as an artist, all of those things lead to a really peaceful acceptance of what's cool and like curiosity about where you can go. Because I would love to be in an action movie. I would love to like kick a door down, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think I'd be awesome at it too because I'm so unlikely. I'm rather gentle and I'm not, you know, I'm not what you might think, but like that's also why Harrison Ford is really good in The Fugitive, because he plays like a doctor with a beard. And you're like, what? He's not even good at like being anything except for he's a man that's just running away. Mm-hmm. That's why that movie rules, because you feel that. You know, I mean, I love The Fugitive, whatever.
It's a great movie.
Call that up, but,
still a great movie.
Yeah, no, it's a great movie.
Andy Davis sat right over there.
I don't know. I think I just want to feel good about what I do. And there's no point in not trying to do that.
Is there a sense, I mean, I get the sense from your work and from Gillian's work and your work obviously along with it, that there's a kind of communities, it feels almost like there are four or five communities of younger artists who are kind of supporting each other, and they kind of, you know, you work with Nick a lot, and you work with a lot of, there are a lot of people we see you with a bunch of times, and then, you know, Aubrey Plaza kind of has her group over there, and it seems like it works for everybody, like, they found a way to get enough money that they don't have to starve to do the things that everybody wants to do these days.
There's also a community in New York, like a filmmaking community, where I feel like it's not as competitive as maybe it was a couple of years ago or a decade ago. Like, we hang out, as not often, because, you know, we're in our own bubbles, apartments, you know, trying to write and get the next project made. But I have lunch dates with, like, Alex Ross Perry and Eliza Hittman. You know, we both have children, and we share, you know, emails, and we're connected through Instagram, so I know what set she's on, and she knows what set I'm on, and we're supportive of each other's work. And it doesn't, it's, for me at least, it's not competitive. It's really exciting, and we're all coming up together and trying to sort of make art and make money and rent and have health insurance, and it's, and also have integrity while doing it.
So do you have the ambition to, I mean, if they came to you tomorrow with a Marvel movie, would that be something you were really interested in? Or, obviously, you'd have to think about it for a minute, but.
Big movies have come my way, and I had to, like, have very strange secured passwords to read the scripts. I won't name any names of the movies, but I hadn't connected to the material. But if I connect to a big movie, whether it's Marvel or Barbie or whatever, I would do it. But there has to be a strong connection, because you mentioned it earlier, it's years and years of your life, and you don't know if it's going to get greenlit, and it's a lot of time to spend away from, you know, your family, and it's a big endeavor. So you better love the story.
Yeah.
You better love the people you're working with, or be able to tolerate them.
Well, if you go in just trying to make it work, like Jenny was saying, then maybe you're going to have a failure at the end of it also, and 3 years hitting to something that's not happy is not good.
I mean, a failure is one thing. If that's the end result, then that's the end result. But if it's that along the way, you were silencing yourself, you were fragmented in one way or another, you disrespected yourself, or you felt creatively starved.
That's going to happen all
that,
the time.
I don't think that needs to happen.
It,
you know,
does.
Like, I don't think that. I think that, like,
no, I don't want it to happen, but it ends up happening occasionally.
Occasionally it does, I guess. But not.
But that's what's so nice about having this partnership and this collaboration.
Yeah.
Because you do have a team, and it's not a struggle. This team doesn't struggle. I mean, we push each other and we propel each other, but we don't block it, you know?
Yeah.
Well, I would think if you got into something you didn't really like as a director, but you were doing it to pay the rent and everything else, that you would, that would be an experience also, and you would have that experience, and then you would
exactly
figure out not to have it again.
I put on my Homer Simpson glasses and be asleep. No, I wouldn't.
Yeah. I can't quite figure out how Barbie could be any good at all. It's there's got to be an answer somewhere in there, but it's scaring the hell out of me. Like,
is
I'm not sure what they're trying.
Is that gonna be a movie?
They're trying really hard to get it made for next summer. And so they've gone through a few people already, in and out, and it's just seems like a terrible idea. But
it's not good to rush anything before, you know, it runs out. You know, I think that's what they're rushing for, right?
Same thing with the Scarface remake. It's like,
oh, I heard about
that. When everybody keeps on dropping out, you're like, maybe they should do it in such a hurry.
It's so campy. How are they going to?
Yeah, I don't know. So as a producer, are you, how ambitious are you? Do you want, I mean, is your ambition to make, to work at a higher level and to work with artists, or is it an ambition to be build an empire and be a producer?
I think of myself as a writer first.
Okay.
Yes, I definitely have ambitions of empire as a writer and a creator, and I think as a producer, I want to work with artists who inspire me and who I can actually be helpful to, and whose work I can, you know, facilitate and enhance, and where I can offer them something, and where we can learn from each other. So I'm pretty selective about thinking about producing things, and I'm not writing because of that. But I think there's so many incredible voices out there, you know, which was how Gillian and I found each other, was being really inspired by and excited about her voice and Jenny and working with them. So they've set my bar real fucking high. So I think if I could meet that bar, then yes, there's more projects like that in my future.
So if you had your druthers, you would just be writing?
I really like doing both. I have a very balanced sort of like left brain, right brain vibe, and depending on the day, one is maybe leading a little more than the other. I really like the whole experience from the seed of an idea to actually executing it. So I think that writing and producing together suit me really well, because ultimately both are about telling a story and actually making sure that it gets told and made and seen and shared. So I want to do it all. I'm just getting started.
So I'm sure you guys were on a tight schedule, so there was that complication of making the movie, but was this a hard set? It seems like a place that were with a lot of actors who are pretty loose and smart.
It was a great set.
It was chill.
It was
yeah.
so great. You know, it was different than Obvious Child because we went from a 25-person crew to a 75-person crew. And at first I was, you know, a little intimidated by the number, but I walk on the set and it's the same. It still feels like the 5-person set that I, you know, had in film school, because it's still me. The hard part of this set was that I was pregnant. No, I wasn't pregnant. I was pumping. So I did a lot of breaks to go pump, and sometimes that was either in front of a crew member or another actor.
Or in the back of a minivan.
Or in a minivan. But that was kind of nice because I could sort of step away and recalibrate and think about the next scene without any questions. You know, is this road? Are you like this? I'm just alone in the minivan, AC pumping, and I can just really recalibrate.
So when you start production, are you and Jenny like completely in the same hive brain together? At that point, have you talked about the character and where you are? And
oh yeah, we have the luxury, because we wrote this role for Jenny,
right,
that we were sending Jenny drafts early on and talking about her character years before we went into production, which is amazing. And it's a luxury because you don't have that with any actors, especially on, you know, indie budgets where you really have a table read, maybe, and then it's really rehearsing almost in the master shot. But we had the chance to really get this character in Jenny's brain as soon as we wrote it and have discussions, lengthy discussions with Jenny about
it. So what's it like when Totoro comes in, or?
It's like a hurricane tornado of,
John Tornado. I like to call him John Turtle.
Yeah. It's great. I mean, you know, your hope is that you cast the right person to sort of fulfill the words on the page, but then usually what happens when it is the right person is that it goes beyond that. And he has comedic talent, but also strength, and his character is sort of, you know, he's making a lot of mistakes. We wanted him to be vulnerable. We wanted him to not be a villain. We wanted him to be kind of a likable, goofy dad who's just, you know, not getting it, not tapped into his family or his or himself. And John did it all.
It was like very low-key performance for him.
Yeah, it's really different.
Yeah.
And I feel very proud that I was like, you know, involved in like in something that I remember seeing. I think the first time I saw John in anything was in Quiz Show. And just I remember seeing that performance and just being like, I've never seen anyone in a movie who's like this. Mm-hmm. He's completely unique. And my parents were really into, or my dad especially, like really into showing me unique performances. Mm-hmm. I think that like my dad really loves John Turturro anyway, but
all dads love John Turturro.
Yeah.
Good statement.
But John, I felt like John was doing something in this film that was at once so like indicated by the script, it was so within the world, and then also such a like he just completely relaxed into something that seemed new.
Yeah.
He's such a good actor.
Well, it's like some actors get lost in the character, and he is always John Turturro, but he's never the same. I mean, completely wildly different characters, every one of them.
Yeah,
he's and wonderful. He and Edie had never worked together before. Huh. They both came up in New York in the 90s as actors and friends, because Edie has worked with John's cousin on Sopranos. Mm-hmm. I think they've had many Thanksgivings together, but they've never been in a scene together. They've never been in a couple on or off screen. So that was really nice to be able to bring them in into that world. And they, having that experience with each other and that sort of shorthand of friendship allowed for them to, you know, for that to translate to their relationship on screen.
And you got a table read?
We got a table read.
We got a table read.
We did, we broke off into little groups, so, you know, we paired Jenny and Abby together.
And how did you find Abby? Because she is kind of an amazing find, particularly next to Jenny.
Doug Abel and Stephanie Holbrook, these amazing New York casting directors who do a lot of, like, Noah Baumbach movies. And they know New Yorkers, and it's unfamiliar faces that they sent our way. You know, it wasn't just the same old group. And Abby Quinn's tape blew us away, and when we met her in person, she was just incredibly strong and giggly too. And so she had this old soul, but she also had this, you know, youth to her. She's from Michigan. She's nothing like this character.
She
sometimes,
said, "Dad."
Yeah, sometimes her Michigan accent came out, but it was great. And she, in the audition, she had straightened her hair, but we all have curly hair, and when someone straightens their hair, you know.
I straightened my hair today.
Yeah,
it's lovely.
I did.
Well, yeah.
I've been smelling it too. It smells really good.
I'll get in there. It's not true.
But Abby had, you could tell, curly hair, and we knew that, you know, Jenny was going to be her sister, and John Turturro, the dad, so it was just a
curly. And did that chemistry just connect right away between them? Because you really buy them as sisters.
Yeah, it did.
It did
because I think Jenny on day one just sort of walked into Abby's trail. Well, first we had some rehearsing time, and that was just sort of really getting to know the words and the script and each other a little bit, but Jenny went into Abby's trailer and I think was open and sisterly from day one with her, and in a very organic way. There was no calculation there.
No, it was like, you know,
who Jenny is.
I wanted to. I'm a middle of two sisters, so I'm in a sisterhood, and our thing's like a sisterhood too. In fact, I'm like the middle child of this one too. This is exactly what my actual family is like in terms of like
age.
Yeah, my older sister is like the same amount older, and little sister is the same amount younger. But also, you know, I felt like I was thinking about Abby on the first day, and that she had said that she really liked Obvious Child, and I was like, oh, you know, we're just kind of being ourselves. But that movie was like meaningful to her, and like I'm like thinking, like, remember, that was a movie. It was like a movie, you know? She thinks she's here with like movie people. But we're just us.
So let me go partner trailer.
So let me go. But so I went in there and I was like, hey, you know, I don't know. Hold for sound. Yeah, we just talked it out a little bit. But I mean, that's how you begin. Is, you know, like, it's easier, I think, to do a scene with someone who is your parent. If you don't know them that well, that's okay. Because in general, a lot of people tend to oversimplify their parents and to not see them. Like, I always had this feeling, and I think it's also in our movie, that it's like, my parents know whatever I think they know, you know, which is not true. They actually know a lot of other stuff, and they have a totally unique personal experience that you're not a part of.
And the movie is about realizing that.
Yeah, the movie's totally about realizing that. So it's fine if I'm not hanging out with Edie in her trailer, although, you know, like, I would like to.
We all want to hang out with Edie.
Yeah, and that's lovely too, but it was important to me to feel like I knew some cues about what Abby looks like when she's comfortable, when she's excited, when she's shy. Just those like very general markers. And I also was like, selfishly gave myself permission to be a little bit big sister-y to her. And
also,
that just clicked in.
Also, what's kind of cool about shooting in New York, we did have trailers on this movie.
Yeah,
but a lot of times
trailers.
We were shooting in locations where it was just easier to hang out in the apartment that we shot in. So a lot of times, this group of actors were together in a room, the only room that had air conditioners in there.
Totally.
And they were bonding, you know, and not in their trailers. And they were doing family stuff.
Yeah. Eating snacks and chatting.
Yeah.
I remember the one day that we got to do a little rehearsal with you and Abby, we were working through the scene where you come into the country house and flip out at each other, and there's, you know, the line of like, you're like a little piece of toilet paper that gets stuck to somebody's shoe.
Yeah.
And you guys were like, there's got to be like a good comeback. Like, there has to be like a sisterly diss.
Yes.
Which bore like, you know, you're the embodiment of constipation. And I was just like, all right, these girls are sisters. Like, they can just give and take like rapid fire, and it was perfect.
Yeah. That, I love filming that scene too.
Oh my God, it's so fun.
I love like throwing the duffel bag at Jed.
I think you were very giving to her as a comedic actor. I think you know comedy and timing so well that I think you left windows and openings for her to be funny as well. And I know her character is a little more sarcastic and not as more of the straight man in their comedy duo, but she had good zingers, and I think she did.
Yeah.
She only was able to really get there with the help of Jenny guiding her, and I think, you know, it's effortless. You don't really see that on screen, but, you know, from behind the monitor, I could see that what Jenny was doing with her, all of her co-workers and people in scenes where she's really listening.
Well, it's a lot of that. I mean, in some ways it felt like Obvious was more, a little more structurey than this is in terms of storytelling, and this seemed like there was a little more room of people just kind of breathing in the space, particularly between the sisters and some quiet moments with Totoro and Edie.
Yeah, I mean, that's cool that you think that, because I think that maybe we did a good job to make this movie feel very lived in and real and honest, because this had a lot of structure, and
But it's a lot more frenetic going back and forth between different stories, and it feels like a more sprawling world. Whereas with Obvious Child, it's a very tight. Jenny's in every single frame. There's three stand-up sets, and it has a very sort of clear, tight 83 minutes.
So the other
this one stretches out a little bit.
Yeah, it does.
More.
It does.
We stretch our legs.
So when you're done shooting, what is post like for you guys? Or does Jenny
I edit
look over
the
your shoulder?
Whole thing.
We bring in Avid in and we tie Jenny to a chair.
I do ADR and I do everyone's lines in the voices of the people.
We worked again with our amazing editor who worked on Obvious Child, and I went to film school with Casey Brooks. And this time around was great because we weren't editing on nights and weekends. For Obvious Child, Liz and I went back to our day jobs after we shot the whole movie. And, you know, it was a lot of editing at work, you know, watching Vimeo clips. And then giving notes and then meeting up on Saturdays and Sundays. And
Casey gave us all his weekends.
He gave us a lot. He also had a day job too, which was Obvious Child. So he was working, you know, 7 days a week. So this one we had, it was our full-time job. We get to go into the edit suite, you know, and I made sure it was in Brooklyn so it was close to home, and it was a great summer.
And how much do you find in the editing on a picture like this versus kind of knowing the script is coming together and you just have all the right pieces?
Oh man, we found so much. There were so many like little nuanced things that were missed, you know, a lot of stuff that Edie was giving us during the shoot that you could sense and feel on set, but then to see it in the edit was just such a wonderful treat. And the sister story really came alive. It was always a story about a family crumbling and trying to find each other and their voices and come back together, and two sisters who don't get along in the beginning of the film and then they do at the end. But Jenny's performance and Abby's performance and their chemistry together was something, again, that you felt on set, but then when you were sitting in that dark room, it was just magnetic and it really reshaped the movie in many ways.
I think we also found kind of a tone that maybe we didn't necessarily know, you know, when we started, when we set out in the script stage. I think in the edit, sometimes there's a lot of pressure to be funny and fast. And I do believe our movie is funny. We like to say it's like a drama where you laugh a lot. And I don't know if when we started making this movie, we thought we were making a drama. You know, I think our work on Obvious Child 2 kind of rides that line between comedy and drama and hopefully, you know, has humor and also heart. And I think in this one, in the edit, and also as we were doing all our feedback screenings and stuff, it seemed like the things that people were really responding to and that we needed to lean into was kind of taking the pressure off like a joke kind of pacing and just people enjoying feeling feelings. You know, we had our premiere last night and so many people came up to tell me that we made them cry and fuck us for doing that, but also like that was awesome.
Somebody's
and they needed to cry.
Cried for 7 minutes straight.
Yeah.
After the screen.
And I'm just
like, you timed it?
Got you. Yeah. I think like those are the movies that we watch over and over that are on like TBS on a Sunday morning are like, you know, Terms of Endearment and Postcards from the Edge and even A League of Their Own makes me weep.
Oh my God.
Of course. These are my people.
When Betty Spaghetti's husband died?
Oh God. Oh, chair.
So is this...
I gotta go.
Now you gotta replay A League of Your Own.
Oh my God.
We can do it right now.
So did it take extra long to do it, to cut it that way? Or did it just kind of.
No, what was nice is because this time around we
got to do it all day.
We got to do it all day, and because of, you know, union rules, I had 10 great weeks. You get the director's cut, you get 10 weeks before, you know, you have to submit it to the financiers, producers. So, that was great to have.
And did you show it to your talent along the way, or did you?
No, I think we...
I don't want that.
I don't think with Obvious Child, we We showed rough cuts.
It's not good for anybody to do that.
I mean, watching the assembly yourself is, you know, very difficult.
Well, it's considered the worst day for any director, yeah, was that first assembly.
Yep, a lot of tears. But then, you know, 3-4 months later, you have something that's feeling good, and then sometimes you tear it apart one or two more times, and then you finally say, if I'm futz with this anymore, I'm going to whittle it down to nothing. So you have to, I mean, I would still be editing Obvious Child if I could.
So when did you finally see it?
A little before Sundance.
Yeah, like when they said that the movie had gotten into Sundance, I think I must have seen it before we went there. Mm-hmm. But I just have a little bit of a problem watching myself. I think many performers do.
Absolutely.
I can't even listen to my own voicemail message. Cringe.
I don't mind listening to my voice, but I'm always surprised when I watch myself. It looks so different inside, you know, mm-hmm, when you're doing it. I just see the outside world, and to my detriment, or whether or not it's a strength, I don't know, but like, I'm not one of those people that knows what my best angle is.
I think our DP, Chris Teague, who's now shot Obvious Child, yeah, the pilot that we did in Landline, knows Jenny's face very well, mm-hmm, and shoots and lights it in a way
that is
so beautiful and captures your just raw beauty in a way that I don't, you know, I mean, I think you look beautiful in everything, but
thank
I think
you.
In our movies you look
I love how I look in Gillian's movies. Yes. Also because I'm not like overly done up. Mm-hmm. I don't like, I usually wear like eye makeup a little bit, but like they don't put anything on my face, but you know, except just a moisturizer.
I think
and
a
gross eyebrow ring.
We take it off too.
Yeah.
We start.
We had a little bit of dark lipstick in this because it was the 90s, but yeah, like the idea that
but
I would
for
have
special occasions.
You know, stuff on my face, it's not happening. And it can happen sometimes, but I prefer not. And I love the way that these women dress me in their films. It's, it feels very natural. It feels like women that I really know in the world, and mm-hmm, it feels like I'm not being dressed in a reaction to anything.
Or for a man.
Right. Like, I'm certainly, you know, no one in our films is dressed in a way that bows down to or caters towards what you would call the male gaze. It's also not a reaction that is like, I'm just doing my own weird thing just for me because I don't even care. It's the way that Dana Jacobs in our movie Landline dresses is sort of like, she's like, I want to look nice for the world, but mm-hmm, in my own style, you know, like, and I really like that. I think that's a really balanced attitude, and Dana is a little bit of a square, and I like that as well because I haven't ever played a dork.
Everything is to service the character.
Yeah.
Everything from the way that their apartment is decorated to the clothes that they wear, the hairstyles, the music they listen to, it's all in service of the character and story. It's such a visual medium. Why would you ever put a character who's supposed to work at, you know, a paper magazine in, like, you know, Dior?
Right.
And that's what I hate the most about a lot of
When one character has 12 winter jackets for every single
one. Or a pink, a pink suit. Which is very funny in the movie.
Well, that was, you know.
So do you, I feel like I asked you this before, but did you make faces in the mirror as a kid? Was that...
Me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are you very conscious of what you're doing when you're...
Not when I'm acting. It's just not worth it. Like, I mean,
it's hard to do that.
I think if you try to... Where I get tripped up is like trying to look pretty and trying to look normal. those are things that are like totally general terms that, mm-hmm, if I focus on them, are actually based off of like some weird, totally non-existent eye that's looking at me and judging me, and that's like, that will hinder a performance. I feel like if I'm really doing something weird, like my face, I'm making like a crazy face, that Gillian will come in and be like, you're doing something crazy, mm-hmm. you know. But in general,
But I don't say that. I don't say.
I assume a lot of the time you like the face when it comes.
Well,
up
I don't say you're doing something crazy. I think
she would never do that.
Where it's just like that's a little Jenny. That's a little Donna. Like
right.
We have almost like safe words that we know with each other.
Like one thing that I do in life that I think we were trying to not do in this movie is like a lot of times in life I notice that when I'm processing emotions or when I feel stress, I tend to like really like take almost a like make a straw shape with like really like blow it out, you know, like totally Lamaze myself in a way. Like really I take a lot of deep breaths and a
so
lot
good
of sighs and I you know like really am and Dana wouldn't really be that way, and I did try to frame her emotional response in a different way, but you know, unless I'm playing someone who is incredibly vain, I don't really feel like my own totally normal human vanity is gonna serve me. And it's a fucking relief to leave it at the door and just be like, I don't know, in this scene, I'm wearing a brown velvet thong bodysuit, ugly giant pink underwear, that are elastic right in the like fleshiest part of my hip, and I have bruises all over myself because I've been falling all, you know, like whatever other scene we did where I fell down or banged into, you know, like, and I look like a real woman, and this is what they want, and I don't have any questions about that. Now I just have to focus on making this seem like it happened.
But one of my favorite moments in the movie is you in the mirror in the moment after you've just. When you just
that you can see it creep up
is
and you know
everything
what?
And everyone in
the theater. I felt like that.
No, everyone has had
that
mirror
moment.
Wait,
not the eyebrow ring.
No,
the bathroom.
I like that too.
And also, now you start when you talk to yourself in the mirror. I actually think your mirror moments in our movies are some of the primo moments.
Shit, maybe I should like look
you
at the monitor and like what.
No, but last night everyone really connects to the creeping up, the self-discovery, the self-realization. I mean, it's like there's no dialogue that could have played that any better. I think it is.
Those are fun.
Yeah.
You know, those moments, those mirror moments, I do love them because I remember acting that and just feeling, oh, I love acting. Like, I love acting. But, like, acting it and being like, oh, my God, I know what this is. Like, I'm so excited to do it. I got to take my energy level down because I'm really excited to perform right now. But just that thing in the mirror where it's like you're so, and then you feel it and it's so annoying. Like
that's
you,
the second to last
that,
time you
know,
shot
it's just,
too.
Oh, yeah, it's delicious. I love acting.
And you see that happening when you're in the set.
Yeah, of course.
You know she got it.
Yeah, yeah. I can see it, I can feel it, and I can hear reactions. I'm just hypersensitive to that, you know, to the set and to her. Mm.
And so outside of the set, do you like being a fashion icon, which you seem to be these days?
Oh.
I keep on seeing it in magazines that you're a
really?
Fashion icon. I do.
I haven't seen myself in any magazines, but I don't look into those. Because I think it's, I don't know. Like the magazines at the nail salon?
I don't go to the nail salon very often.
Well, New York Magazine just did a whole piece
it's
about
when
how
you go
you're
to
like
the
style icon and that your personal style rules.
Oh, wow, I didn't see it. How
and it's
you didn't
accurate.
Tell me? I mean, see, I don't know.
Jenny, did you see yourself in New York Magazine?
No, I didn't. All
right.
I'll send you a link.
She's
my
old
mother,
on
my own mother is not here to tell me this stuff.
All right, I'll send you a link.
I would love it. I love clothing. And I find great joy in it. And my mom, not a clothes horse, buys all her clothes at like Costco, which is fine for her. She literally
not really Costco
no,
though.
She buys her clothes at
Costco. Well,
yeah.
Okay, not Ross. Costco.
Or what about like the Vermont Country Store?
She doesn't know about that, but she would.
Oh wow.
She would buy. She has those nightgowns though. Those Lands nightgowns with like turtlenecks that we have in our movie, by the way. I love clothes, and you know what? Growing up, I think my mom was always really like, don't be vain. Don't care about how you look on the outside. And I always remember my grandmother's had a really balanced way of using style to be vibrant in the world. And I remember the first time I saw Gilda Radner and like pictures of her. there was something about her style that was part of everything. Mm-hmm. And I connect to that, and I love it. You know, without being like a label obsessed. Mm-hmm. I like adornment, and I think adornment in the right ways is like a beautiful personal celebration of what you think is holy inside of yourself.
You don't overvalue it, but you take true pleasure in it, and I that do. Is very visible.
Yeah, but I'm not that girl that's like, I don't like these options or whatever.
I just love your rings. I've been looking at the whole time.
I do too. This ring here, my mom is a potter, and we spent a lot of weekends at craft fairs growing up, and sometimes she would allow my sisters and I to roam the craft fairs as a group so we wouldn't get kidnapped. And we could pick something from another artist, and then my mother would go from her, we would watch my mom's booth, and then she would go over to whoever it was, and she'd be like, hello, I'm Nancy Gilson Slate. I make this raku pottery. My daughter Jenny loves this little ring. Mm-hmm. She was like, can we trade? And she traded a small pot for this ring that I used to wear on my pointer.
Your mom is like a Ren Faire barter.
Oh my God, I love it. What? Of course. So this little guy, you know, like everything, and this is my almost, and you know what? This is my great-grandmother's wedding ring. She's a Holocaust survivor. She is, and I wear it, and I love it. I think it's beautiful. Yeah.
Well, three of you look very glamorous in the movie selfies, the Landline premiere selfies. I saw a couple of those.
With our little pink telephone.
Yeah. And all in black dresses. And
I know, it wasn't on purpose, but
you look like sisters.
Always wind up dressing like a band by accident.
Yeah, I want to know who the drummer is, because you know what, Liz? Mm-hmm. It's you. You know who else is a drummer?
I'm not interested in fighting that.
And I started taking drum lessons. Oh my God, I thought you were going to say I started taking drugs. I was like, oh, weird. Yes, I agree.
Yeah.
You just started taking drugs, Liz.
Just Tylenol PM.
You know who else is the drummer? In the Muppets, it's Animal.
Oh,
perfect. That's like really good.
Perfect. Animal's the best.
I'm Gonzo.
Are you?
I feel that I'm Gonzo.
Are you sure?
What do you think
I'm not Gonzo.
Oh, it's gonna be double Gonzo time. There's nothing else to do.
You're not Kermit?
No.
I don't think so. It's a Gonzo and Gonzo situation.
I'm probably like the in Muppet Babies, you know, just like the legs.
Do you know what? I'm
adult.
I am the legs. No, they're redoing Muppet Babies and I'm the legs.
No, what?
No, I'm serious. I just recorded like 18 minutes ago.
That's a dream. Wow.
I know. And not to be a bitch, but I get to go to Disneyland for free and I've never been.
You've never been to Disneyland?
Land.
Oh, I've never Land been to is Disney way better.
I was there recently World? And so
I've been to Disneyland.
Do you get to do Epcot Center too?
I think Epcot's only in
that's
Florida.
A Disney World
that
only.
Is, I thought that's where you
should go. No Disneyland here. In Anaheim.
Oh, okay.
Wait, are your legs pink and white striped? Do you know?
I don't know. I don't know. I didn't see the animatic.
When I was a small child, I worked for Jim Henson, and I always remember the day they lost Manamana. And I spent an entire day trying to find Manamana in boxes in the warehouse. Oh. And he was like missing, and we found him finally.
You know what the truth of it is? Is that I'm not really a Muppet, but what I really am is Grover. Mm-hmm. And I know it.
You are I wasn't sure about Gonzo, but Grover feels like that's right in the groove.
Yeah, and there's like, I remember the Sesame Street episode where Lena Horne sings to Grover. She sings that song about like saying hello. She's like, hold out your hand. And like, she tells him how to, and she gives him like little kisses on his head. And I just remember being like, I'm either that lady or I'm Grover or I'm both. Maybe that's what I am. I love Grover.
So opening day is a few minutes away.
Yes.
Will you guys be particularly nervous on opening day, or have you already kind of shot your wad on this and had the happy experience and you hope it does well, but
I'm nervous, of course. It's exciting. And you make a movie in a bubble, and then you also make it for people to enjoy and find love in and hopefully are entertained by. So yeah, I hope people like it. I hope people go see it. But I'm also planning to potty train my toddler right after. So I'm thinking about both of those things at the same time. So it's always nice to have something that grounds you and reminds you that life is not just opening weekends. But yeah, terrified.
I feel like we've got the right amount of like geez, I hope people see our lovely movie. And, like, if they do, that'll be great, and I think they will. And also, like, I don't know, there's a whole life out there. Anyway, we're gonna have to make something else after this.
Right.
Yeah. You know, like, this is the time that is the least connected to, for me at least, to what I do for a living.
Mm-hmm.
I am always very into that, looking for interesting work, doing the interesting work, looking again, doing it, and then resting.
And by the time opening day rolls around, there's not really much left to do. You've been a total lunatic for the last number of months and weeks and
right.
days. And then at a certain point, you just gotta
eat popcorn.
You just gotta eat popcorn, yeah.
Yeah.
Relax.
But you don't have that competitive, we gotta be big sick kind of thing going on.
Of course we do, but we won't, so it's fine.
Why you turn just, the camera off?
Then you can fight Kamal live, or you can fight Zoe, it'd be good.
Aww.
So the last couple things, which of course I don't normally do, are you actually doing the Warner Brothers Looney Tune thing? Is that real or is that an IMDb fantasy?
That was many, many years ago.
Okay.
Yeah. I wrote like a couple drafts of a screenplay for them for a movie that I am not a part of.
Okay.
Yeah. That was an interesting experiment, but I'm not a gun for hire, but I had to see.
It was interesting you were doing it as a writer.
Yeah.
It was at least how they listed you. So that was,
yeah, I was a writer.
They've
yeah.
been trying so desperately to figure out how to revamp all, get all that
drafts.
Going again for years. It's
yeah,
a hard
I wrote
time.
A couple drafts, but my idea wasn't...
It was great.
It was,
too great.
My idea was a beautiful idea. I think they ended up wanting something less... Something
less
more
awesome.
Of what they had seen before.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah.
And they keep on, that's why they keep on not getting going, I don't think, because this has been going on for 20 years. And somebody, I actually went on Twitter and asked people for questions, because I never ever do. But somebody asked what your favorite two songs of the 90s were.
Mine?
Yes. But now I want for all three of you.
Oh, shit.
I mean, that's really hard, but if I had to, like, pick, like, what comes to mind,
mm-hmm.
I would probably say
Sylvie B. Hawkins, Damn,
oh,
I Wish I Was Your Lover.
I don't know.
It's
like,
in there.
A Fiona Apple song. Like, I was really into Fiona Apple. Something off the title album.
Mm-hmm.
Probably Paper Bag. That was the late 90s. I loved that song. And then you know what else I loved? And I think this is the 90s, but it might be late 80s. But loved Have a Heart by Bonnie Raitt.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
That's a great album.
Oh, that answers
album
Jenny.
Rules. Yeah. But I also love I Want to Be Down by Brandy. Song rules. Yeah. And Regulators. Mama.
Gillian?
This is so hard. It's kind of
I
in the movie.
It.
Well, then the movie is set in 95, is it?
Yeah, so it was definitely Breeders, Driving on 9, which is a B-side from Last Splash. So that is definitely one of my favorite songs. And I think, I guess, what was I, in 1995, I was really into, because I was in high school, Breeders and Beastie Boys.
Well, I have a tendency to get drunk and sing Weezer, Say It Ain't So.
That's nice.
So that's definitely in there. Damn, Wish I Was Your Lover is definitely in there. Fiona Apple, but like just classic Criminal, definitely in there. What else?
Four Non-Blondes.
Uh-huh. Mm.
You know what we're kind of forgetting is like Part of Your World from The Little Mermaid.
A lot of the Disney dialogue is
what
we're
forgetting. I had the VHS tape with the penis in the
character. Me too.
My mom still has it.
I had the one with the boner.
Yeah,
you don't leave a lover. It comes right up.
And then also I'm a girl,
it's
so like the once on this island, like the entire, I could get real nerdy on you. But,
oh my God.
I think
yeah.
like on my third or fourth date with my husband, we did like a 90s YouTube party in my kitchen where we were getting drunk and just going down the 90s song
list
and making it a dance party, making him watch me dance and sing to all my favorite 90s songs.
Also, what's like, Cranberries Dreams?
Oh!
Could we go out?
You can all sing along.
I wanted that, but Chung King did such a good job with it. You can't really.
You know, I used to really like to annoy my whole family by doing the part in Dreams where she's like, loved it. Loved just wailing out on that one.
And have you guys had a conversation where you think maybe your next movie is coming from yet, or are you a year away from that happening?
I think we probably had many
that we don't know about yet, but yeah.
The gold in my ear story.
I like it.
Not everybody knows young Golda was a sexually active girl in New York City.
Young Golda. Oh, brother.
What a good name.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm so sweaty. Thank you.